So when should you get a CGM? Maybe your doctor has mentioned a CGM to you and you're not so sure about it. A CGM is a continuous glucose monitor. If there's one thing I would have done differently is I would have gotten a CGM earlier along my diabetes journey. In my book, Success with LADA Diabetes, I talk about how a CGM is out of the world amazing. And that is so true for anybody who is trying to figure out what's going on with their blood sugar. Even if you are just in the early stages of this diabetes, CGM gives you so much more information than what a blood glucose test gives you. So typically, if you have diabetes or pre-diabetes, your doctor might say, well, you should start checking your blood sugar. And at a minimum, you should probably check it in the morning after you wake up, and you should write down the number of what your blood sugar is because you want to see if your diabetes is getting worse or how is it doing, right? And for LADA diabetes, it's a journey. So over time, it might suddenly get worse and you definitely want to know, oh, wow, my blood sugar is a lot higher now than it used to be, right? And then you might need to have a different treatment for your diabetes. But a CGM has so many more benefits than just not having to prick your finger. Yeah, not having to prick your finger is a big benefit because pricking your finger, if you keep pricking your fingers might get sensitive. Use your fingers for touching stuff. You don't really want to have sore fingers. There are blood test blood meters that let you prick other places like your palm instead of your tip of your finger. But that's just like the tip of the iceberg about why a CGM is so good. Continuous glucose monitor shows a graph and it shows a trend arrow. Is your blood sugar staying about the same? Is it going up fast, going up a little bit at a time? Nose diving down or, you know, trending down slowly. A CGM tells you, oh, did my blood sugar spike a lot after that meal I ate? Did it stay high for a long time? Oh, did I get low blood sugar? Is this weird feeling I'm feeling, is this low blood sugar or is this just generalized anxiety? Generalized anxiety and low blood sugar can feel very similar. If you are using insulin to manage your blood sugar, it can tell you, did I get the right insulin dosage for my meal? So I was so amazed when I got a CGM that I wrote a blog post about it. All about all the things I learned about myself and about insulin. Without having a CGM, I would give myself an insulin dose with my meal. And then afterwards, I would really be really anxious after dinner. Oh, is my blood sugar okay? And I would have to check my blood sugar and maybe check it more than once. So it gives so much more information. And that allowed me to manage my blood sugar better because I wasn't afraid of going low all the time. So before having the CGM, sometimes I would actually eat a little bit more because I didn't want to go low. Whereas the CGM, it will give me an alert before low. It'll predict that I'm going to go low. And then therefore I can eat something with sugar in it then and never go low because it prevented the low. It told me ahead of time. And likewise, if my blood sugar is not low, but I feel like shaky or something, maybe it's from all the caffeine in the coffee I just drank, or maybe it's because I'm anxious about something, or maybe there's some other weird hormonal thing going on or some virus or something. It's just making me feel weird, but my blood sugar is fine. So I don't have to keep checking my blood sugar or eat more food. So having a CGM is invaluable. When should you get a CGM? As soon as possible, if you want to know what's going on. If you're early on in this LADA diabetes journey, maybe you won't even need it all the time. Although personally for me, I could not see not having one, but I was already at the point of using insulin for my diabetes. And insulin is very difficult to dose correctly. Even for the same exact food, sometimes insulin dosage required is different because there are other factors like the amount of activity you're doing or not doing, or if you get sick like with COVID or like a cold virus, if you're sick with an infection, you might suddenly need more insulin, become more insulin resistant. There is amazing variability in how much insulin you can need to manage your blood sugar with insulin. So a continuous glucose monitor, a CGM, Usually people wear them on their arm, although I now usually wear mine on my thigh. It's hidden away. You can also on your abdomen. It is also a common place to wear a CGM. The Freestyle Libre CGM was the first one I used. It was cheaper than the Dexcom one. There are some other options available now, and the variability of the number of brands of CGMs is increasing. So by the time you watch this video, there may be more options as well. So talk to your doctor, and if cost is a concern, tell her that cost is a concern, and get some comparisons on what the different ones cost per month, because it's not always, cost isn't always the most forefront thing in the doctor's mind. She may just be prescribing the CGM that she prefers. But if it costs too much, you're not going to get it, right? So it's important that you find an affordable option. There are some over-the-counter CGMs too. Some things to look for in a CGM is you want to look for a CGM that lets you change the alert levels. So it should be customizable, so you can tell it when you want a alarm to go off. The high alarm in particular, you should be able to adjust that to a number that really makes sense to notify you that your blood sugar is high because you're going to take some action. You do not want to get alarms just all the time. You'll just get alarm fatigue if you get alarms and you can't do anything about those alarms and they just bother you. If your blood sugar is high a lot, then yes, you need to talk to your doctor about what you can do to improve that. But alarms all the time, you'll just end up ignoring the alarms. So ideally, you want a CGM that you can adjust the level at which the alarm goes off, and you set it at something that is like, this is a kind of rare event. Your blood sugar has gone high enough that doesn't usually happen. You do want to know about that alarm because you're going to take some action for that. Like if you use insulin, you might give yourself an insulin bolus correction, and definitely talk to your doctor about what that bolus correction amount would be. Or maybe you will go and exercise to try to reduce your blood sugar, which is something for me that reduces my blood sugar quite a bit when I do exercise. Or drinking water is great for trying to lower blood sugar, because your kidneys will try to get rid of the sugar, the extra sugar in your system, but you have to be well hydrated. So drinking water when you have high blood sugar is a great idea too. Relaxing and not stressing out. So again, those alarms, they can be problematic, right? The technology that is so helpful can also be stressful. And then on the lower end of the alarms, most of the CGMs, you can't turn off the alarm that is like so low that like it's dangerous, that you're so low that you have to know about it because it could be dangerous for your health. But there's usually another threshold, like the alert below setting can be configurable, and everybody's different. Some people sit around a fairly low number without a problem, you know, just above the low threshold. Whereas other people, if they get maybe to like 80 milligrams per deciliter, at that point, even though not technically low for them, if they get to 80, they might start feeling symptoms, or maybe that's a sign that their blood sugar is going to drop. So they do want that alert at that level. There is an interesting or fascinating thing here, that when your blood sugar has been high for a long time, you can have this false low, where you feel like you're low when your blood sugar is actually normal. You're lower than you usually are. So it takes some time. If your blood sugar has been high for a long time, over time your body will get used to a lower number, and then it'll adjust downward. So you might need to configure your alarms differently as time progresses. And that's generally what I did, and what I think is common, that you start off with like this big range, like, okay, I'm going to be okay. If it goes up to, it has to go up to like 250 milligrams per deciliter before it's going to alarm, and you know, this wide range. And then over time you lower it down. Okay, now 190, 180 or something like that, 170. Everybody's different in how like narrow of a range they can get their blood sugar. And I think for women with the hormones that affect blood sugar so much, I think variability, you have to accept some variability. Well, we all have to accept some variability, but I think that there's what's reasonable for you may not be reasonable for somebody else. So make sure it's very individualized for you. Another thing to look for in a CGM is a CGM that you can calibrate. So calibration is when you check your blood sugar with a blood glucose meter and you put that number into your CGM to say, this is what my blood glucose really is. And then the CGM will adjust its reading based on that number. And often you need to calibrate like 2 times and then it will be much more accurate. So some of the common complaints is, oh, my CGM, it was so inaccurate, it wasn't useful. Well, if it was so inaccurate, that's not useful, can you calibrate it? And if you can calibrate it when your blood sugar isn't changing much, like calibrate it before you've eaten any food. Don't do it right after exercise. So at a time when your blood sugar is more stable, calibrate it once, wait about 20 minutes and calibrate it again. And then hopefully that will adjust the inaccuracy problem. But if it still persists where the CGM is not accurate, you can contact the manufacturer. They might replace the CGM sensor for you, or you might have to try a different brand. It seems like there's some individual variation in which CGM works best for your particular body. I don't know why this is, but it's like I use the Guardian 4 CGM sensor, which is the sensor that works for my insulin pump. I was going to say it's the only one that works with my insulin pump, but actually the MiniMed 7AG insulin pump that I use now, they just released, there's several new CGM sensors available now that this is a brand new thing, so there's more choices. We need lots of different choices because not everybody's body works the same with every CGM. So you definitely want a CGM that works very well for you. In my case, my blood sugar number is often very close to what the CGM says, surprisingly close. However, if it's off like by 15 to 20 points, and we're talking about the American system, not the metric system, milligrams per deciliter, 15 points inaccuracy or is not considered huge, especially if it's like maybe your blood sugar is changing at the moment. And also one thing to be aware of is the CGM is measuring the interstitial fluid just under your skin. It's not actually measuring the blood level, the sugar in your blood. It's measuring sugar in your interstitial fluid, and there can be some differences between those. And a CGM can take longer to respond. So like if you go low and you have some juice or something with glucose in it to raise up your blood sugar, if you test it with a blood glucose meter, you'll probably see your blood sugar going up sooner than what the CGM reflects the change. So one thing to think about is if you went low and you ate something sugary and you're trying to get your blood sugar up and maybe you're stressed out, like, did I have enough sugar to raise my blood sugar? And your CGM still says that it's low. Do another blood test, because a blood test is like looking into the future. It's like okay, if the blood test says that my blood sugar is better, then probably the CGM will also show that in another 10 or 15 minutes. Plus the CGM reading, usually most of these CGMs are like every 5 minutes it updates. So it's not literally every single minute. It's like a 5 minute interval. Which I did not know. If I look at my CGM, it's still the same number. Well, it takes 5 minutes before it gives you another reading. So 5 minutes is very frequent. It's way better than only testing your blood sugar like 1 to 6 times per day, which is if you have a blood glucose meter. A lot of times they don't give you prescriptions for more glucose strips than like 6 a day, even though 6 times a day is nothing, right? If you want to know, well, how am I doing before the meal? How am I doing after the meal? How am I doing before exercise? How am I doing before I go driving? But testing your blood sugar, finger prick, who wants to do that all the time? So a lot of people will do that less frequently. CGM, every 5 minutes is an amazing amount of data. So continuous glucose monitor. You do not have to already have an insulin pump to use a CGM. You can use a CGM even without using insulin at all. But if you do have an insulin pump, you definitely want a CGM that connects to your insulin pump, because then it can do something called looping, where the insulin pump can read the number from your CGM and it can automatically adjust the insulin to give you more insulin or less insulin. And different insulin pump models different about how aggressive they are or how much looping or automation they do. So that is a really key thing to look into if you're considering an insulin pump. And you can usually get the CGM graph on your phone. That's the primary way to see the graph usually, although there are some devices that have separate reader devices that you can use. And often you can also get it on your watch, which is really great because you don't have to take out your phone to see what's going on. Very convenient there. What questions do you have about CGMs? Do you use a CGM right now? Are you happy with your CGM? Big thing is that sensors don't always last as long as they say they'll last. Like a sensor, most of these sensors are like 7 days or 10 days currently. But people will complain all the time, oh, my sensor just quit working. And that's happened to me too. It usually happens at the worst possible time, like when I'm about to go on vacation, my sensor just quits. Diabetes technology failure is so stressful. One of the things I've done is tried to just like go along with it. Okay, I know every once in a while my diabetes tech is going to fail. And I always keep a glucose meter with me as backup just in case. I also wanted to give a big thanks to my first 120 subscribers here on YouTube. If you have not subscribed yet, it would be terrific if you hit the subscribe button there because YouTube then knows that I'm producing some good content and they will promote my stuff more and that will encourage me to create more content. So please subscribe and like the video. And if you have any thoughts at all, a short comment will also help to promote the video and spread the word about LADA diabetes. I try to be very positive, but also very based in reality. Let me know what other topics you'd like me to talk about. Thank you. Check out my free ebook, What They Don't Tell You About Insulin Pumps, But I Will. What you really need to know before starting. How to navigate the ups and downs of pump life. Lessons they don't always teach you in training. Personal stories, hard-won wisdom, and honest advice. Get your free copy today at insulinpumplife.com or scan the QR code pictured here. When I was diagnosed with LADA diabetes, my endocrinologist said I was a good candidate for an insulin pump. At the time, I had no idea what an insulin pump was and it just felt very scary. Fast forward many years and now I use an insulin pump and it's been a very good decision. Insulin pumps have become very advanced and it makes my life easier. However, it's not all rainbows, so definitely if you're thinking about an insulin pump or want to know more about an insulin pump, check out my free ebook on my website, insulinpumplife.com.